Right.
I think he'd be amazed. I think he'd be, wow, that's interesting that, you know, he's able to generate so much interest.
Of course. Thank you all for tuning in today. We're meeting with Frances Ann Solomon, filmmaker, director, and of course, her most recent project, Heroes, coming out, presented at TIFF on February 28th. And we'll definitely talk about all of that very soon. Mm-hmm. But first things first, thank you very much for meeting with me today. I appreciate
Thank you. I really appreciate it.
Yeah, you're welcome. So tell us about yourself before getting into the filmmaking, before directing.
What do you want to know?
What was your plan before getting into film at all? Tell us about your journey up until this point.
Well, growing up in the Caribbean, I came from a brown middle-class family where, you know, the thing was to have a good job, you know, grow up.
Grow up the same way.
You know what I mean?
Of course.
Absolutely. So there you go. So art was not part of, you know, the plan of my family for
right.
me. That was just not an option, you know, in the Caribbean at the time. Mm-hmm. You were going to be a teacher, even as a girl, you know, a doctor, a
lawyer.
Lawyer,
of course.
But not an artist.
Right.
What is that? Do you know what I mean? So
yeah.
It wasn't until I left Trinidad and I came to Canada, I went to university here, and I got involved in theater, that I began to explore what, you know, the artistic essence of myself, that
oh, okay.
I am an artist. So I then studied theater and became a director, theater director. I studied theater directing, and then I went to England because I don't know, I just wanted to go to Europe. England called, yeah,
of course.
Something new.
It's a very artistic type of area as well, right?
Yeah, and I arrived in England at a point in time when the whole place was exploding. I always tell this story, you know, growing up in the Caribbean, we had black leaders from the 60s. The
right.
prime minister was black. The government was black. And so people who were running the place looked like me and darker, you know. And then coming here and then going to England, it was a different reality. And going to England in particular, it was at a point in time where race violence was exploding.
Right.
Hands with Birmingham, London were in flames. They called them the Black Riots.
Mm-hmm.
And so that was my first experience of like racial violence.
Right.
And I got a job as a reporter on one of the first black magazine programs.
Okay.
It was our job to represent the perspective of black people.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, when it came down to it, they didn't really want to hear what black people had to
right.
say because they were very, very angry.
Mm-hmm.
So that was my first also experience of institutional racism, and you know, in that
really?
Kind of very in your face way,
mm-hmm.
that you know, working as a person at the BBC, you know, there our perspectives, even though that was what we were hired to do,
mm-hmm.
did not matter. You know,
has that evolved over time in terms of the BBC, for example? Are they more open to different viewpoints and opinions of the
well,
other
I think,
person?
I think, you know, I left England in the end. I did quite well in
right.
England. I became a producer in drama. I was always the one and only person of color in my department.
Yeah.
But I left England eventually because it was just too, you know, the racism was too, you know,
it's
I just felt like it was not going to change.
Right.
And I think even after I left, my colleagues and peers told me it actually got worse.
Really?
Really, yeah. And it was only, I think it's only in the, you know, together with the rest of the West in the last 2 years,
right.
literally,
that tensions things, have heightened over time.
That things have begun to open up.
Mm-hmm.
And England later, I really think because England is the center of, or Europe is the center of you know, empire,
right.
that it's harder for them to change than anywhere else.
Mm-hmm.
And so while things have been slowly changing here, little by little by little by little by little by little by little
of course.
Little.
But you are seeing improvement.
Slowly. Very slowly.
Right. But you are seeing the improvement
yeah,
over
time. Yeah, I'm seeing it now.
Right.
You know, just, I think, in the last 2 years, I'm seeing a big change.
Of course.
Yeah.
What do you think has been the reason for that change?
Well, I think Oscar's So White, the whole movement in America that kind of challenged the fact that only white films was like apartheid down there, the Oscars, right?
Right.
So that whole movement reverberated, and Me Too. I mean, the whole, there's a kind of a, somehow there's been a crack in the fissure, and I also think that the Liberal government in Canada, I believe that Justin Trudeau coming in and saying right away gender, you know, gender parity and, you know, immigrants front and center has changed the fabric of Canadian society in a fundamental way.
Mm-hmm.
And there are now opportunities for us in a way that there weren't before.
Right.
And we are getting visibility. You know, I mean, basically the funding agencies in Canada for the last couple of years are mandated to fund diversity.
Okay.
Yeah.
So there's actual incentives for them to do it.
Mm-hmm. So you find a lot of the institutions now running around looking for Black people to put on their boards and people of color and trying to show diversity in their content because it's actually mandated by a lot of the government agencies.
Do you think that has a positive effect or negative effect on
It's transformed the way that we are able to operate because prior we weren't, you know, it was very, very hard to get funding.
Right.
But now we are able to get funding. So it's made a huge difference.
That's fantastic. So tell me about your first film that you produced or that you directed, I should say.
Well, I made two films first. One was called I Is a Long-Memoried Woman, and it was based on a book of poems by a Guyanese writer called Grace Nichols.
Okay.
And she had written in verse the story of the African woman who is, you know, kidnapped and stolen from Africa and brought over to the Caribbean, and her journey of, you know, surviving that experience and you know, and coming to a point where, you know, she has to rebel and lead a revolution. So it's really kind of based on the character of Nanny, who's a Jamaican warrior queen who led, you know, slaves to fight against slavery. And so it's although they say it's the unnamed Black woman, it really is modeled on that character of Nanny, who was a slave and did come over on the ship. And so I made a film about that, using her verse, interviewing Grace, and then interweaving it with dance and song.
Right.
It was great because growing up in the Caribbean, we never learned about slavery.
Right.
I don't know if you did.
I grew up here in Canada, so.
Did you learn about slavery?
Only in February's. It was always Black History Month. These were the things that were taught, you know, going to poems and, you know, Martin Luther King did this or George Washington Carver did that. But it was only that one month was when we heard about it the most.
Because we didn't learn anything about any of that.
Right.
We learned about the kings and queens of England, the Restoration, the Renaissance, and the, you know, various artistic and political movements in Britain between the 15th and the 17th century.
I would have thought it would be in reverse in the Caribbean, that you hear more about the Black leaders and heroes and people that changed society.
Not when I was growing up.
Right.
There was a huge absence. And so for me, arriving in England, which was a highly, like I told you, highly politicized environment, very alight with, you know, divisions. And consciousness and analysis.
Right.
It was a great opportunity for me to learn about where we came from and stuff. And in the Caribbean, you know, a lot of it was a lot of denial. You know, growing up as a brown middle class person in the Caribbean, you know, my family would say things like, some people in my family would say, you know, we're not African. You know that. You know, complete denial.
Right.
We have nothing to do with it. We're Trinidadians. That was on one hand. On the other hand, you know, my grandfather was also one of the architects of independence and stuff like that. So he was a hero. So that was also part of my upbringing.
Right.
But yeah, that was my first film. And then my second film, which I think about as being my first, was more of a personal story about a woman who goes back to the Caribbean when her father dies,
okay,
and meets her mother for the first time. And her mother tells her stories about the breakup of the marriage, and she learns about her father in a different kind of way. And that was a very personal story. So I think that really encapsulates it. My work always has a combination of the personal,
right,
and the, you know, the, for me, the, you know, socio-political, you know. And it's always about, you know, coming to voice,
right,
about expressing, about having a voice and telling, you know, kind of unearthing truths about who we are,
yeah,
as people of African heritage, essentially.
So two questions came out of what you just said. The first one is, what do you think it is about the socio-political aspect of culture that has inspired the films that you've made so far? Why do you want to focus on that topic over, you know, romantic comedies, for example? Is there anything
else? I have done comedies. We did a comedy in, called Lord Have Mercy.
I've heard of that one. Yeah. For sure. Yeah, absolutely.
So that was the first black sitcom in Canada.
Right.
Mm-hmm. And we made it in 2001 to 2006.
Mm-hmm.
It had Russell Peters, Leonie Forbes, Sprang Along.
Absolutely.
Debbie. So I have done comedy, and I think there are always funny things in what I do. I get a lot of pleasure and humor out of it. But even my comedy tends to be political.
Right.
Yeah, it has a political edge. I think, you know, it's important for people to have an analysis of the situation and to be free. I guess that's the bottom line.
Yeah.
I am engaged with the struggles of black people and people of African heritage.
Right.
Because I see that that's where I've come from, and that's what I want to talk about. You know, it's very important to me. And as a woman as well, you know, as a woman as a black woman, a woman of color.
Absolutely.
You know, I think it's really important to unpick that gender perspective. That's who I am. Those are the stories I want to tell.
Right.
Yeah.
And the next question based off of that as well was, you mentioned growing up, you heard, you know, we're not African, we're Trinidadian.
Mm-hmm.
And I've heard this as well and read about it. There's a division between Africa versus Caribbean and sometimes even black Americans or black Canadians. Mm-hmm. Why is there that division there instead of everyone saying, you know, we're all the same people, let's all come together?
Well, I mean, I would say that it's part of the design of the colonizer. It's a false division. And I think it's a tool of the you know, ruling class to divide and rule.
Right.
So it's very important that people don't see similarities between each other, that they only see division.
Right.
It's a very tribal kind of way of seeing the world, that you're over there and we're over here, and, you know, we are better than you and we are more important than you, and therefore if there's resources to be shared, that we should have it, rather than thinking about how we all can benefit.
Right.
So it's completely false divisions. And I think, you know, that was interesting to me. Growing up, we did, you know, Caribbean people generally, when I was a child, did not acknowledge the links to Africa. But there were more links than you would think.
Right.
You know, there were, for example, Hero is about, you know, the Pan-African movement that started at the turn of the century, the turn of the 20th century,
right,
where Caribbean people basically, you know, came up with this plan that people of African heritage would all over the world would come together to, you know, heal and enrich Africa and liberate Africa.
Right.
And that idea, you know, was really brought to light by people like Henry Sylvester Williams, George Padmore, Marcus Garvey. These were, you know, so-called West Indians,
right,
who had this consciousness and this vision and this plan. So while some people were kind of in denial, other people were actively, you know, strategizing and planning and building a movement, which was called the Pan-African Movement. And that's really what Hero was about. And at every step of the way, you had Caribbean people engaged in that, engaged in, so for example, you know, from the turn of the century, there were Caribbean people who were making arrangements with African Americans and people of African and Africans to, you know, build together. And the story of Hero is about a man called Ulric Cross, mm-hmm. who joined the Pan-African movement, at that time led by George Padmore, also Trinidadian.
Right.
And was recruited by Padmore to go to Ghana.
Wow.
Yeah. And that's not a story that we grew up knowing again. You know, we learned so little about who we are. I mean, there were a lot of Caribbean people who were, you know, what some of the things that would happen would be like, there were certain Caribbean people who won scholarships, mm-hmm. went to Oxford, Cambridge, but there they would meet Africans. And so, for example, at Oxford, there was the West Indian Students Union, which was comprised of Africans and Caribbean people who were already plotting to overthrow colonialism. Mm-hmm. And England became a kind of nexus for activism.
Really?
Yes, absolutely.
So there's a lot of rich history behind this, and all of this is kind of poured into the Hero story as well.
Mm-hmm.
No, I read a bit about it, but tell the viewers out there how the Ulric Cross story came across your mind.
Well, in 2012, a man called Desmond Allam, who was mm-hmm. a friend of our family, he was dying. He was dying of cancer, and he called my mother, who was a close friend, going around giving everybody instructions. I want you to do this, I want you to do that.
Right.
He called my mother and he said, I want you to make a film about Ulric Cross. Mm. And then he died. And my mother took this very seriously. She actually raised money for it. Mm-hmm. And then I joined to help her, being the filmmaker in the family.
Of course.
I think that's obviously what he wanted to happen in the first place.
Right.
But I really didn't want to do it at the beginning because I knew a little bit about Ulric. Mm-hmm. He was, you know, also in our family circle. I knew that he had served in the war, in the Second World War.
Mm-hmm.
And he seemed a very kind of, you know, genteel, nice man, you know, very anglicized. Right. I had no interest in telling a story about that kind of person.
Didn't seem captivating enough? Is that what it was?
I'm not, you know.
The spark wasn't there.
I'd already made a film about Caribbean women who served in the Second World War.
I see.
And I thought to myself, you know, I'm really over this story.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not interested in telling yet another story where we say, isn't it amazing that black people also served in white people's wars and got killed?
That's fantastic.
I didn't want to tell that story.
Mm-hmm.
But once I began to research Ulric's life, I discovered this other story, which was that after the war, in that kind of terrible period that happened after the war, which is now coming to light in Britain, where, you know, a lot of the ex-servicemen came to England after the war, and instead of, you know, being celebrated, they were really treated very, very badly. A lot of racism and rejection. But in that dark period, rose, you know, the Pan-African movement kind of came to a head, and Ulric was recruited by George Padmore to go to Ghana.
Right.
And Ghana was, of course, the first African country to become independent.
Mm-hmm.
It was, you know, there was a lot of noise about it at the time. I don't know if you remember when South Africa came out of apartheid.
No.
You were too young. 1990, you know, that feeling where all over the African diaspora, there was this sense like, oh my God, you know, apartheid is over.
Right.
And then the call came and black people all over the world started go to South Africa to offer their services. We will help. And very much the same thing happened 50 years before when Ghana became independent, because it was like, guys, all hands on deck. We have to build a free, independent Africa,
right?
We have to, and Padmore's vision was even broader. He had a vision of the United States of Africa.
Wow.
Yeah. His idea was that all the African countries would become independent, the leaders would join together, you know, form a federation, one currency,
mm-hmm.
you know, like the United States.
Of course.
And for the betterment of the whole continent. Mm-hmm. And so that was his plan. So he recruited people from all over the African diaspora, from the Caribbean, principally. He came from the Caribbean. There was a very high level of British education in the Caribbean. Mm. So he brought lawyers who were languishing in junior lawyer positions in the West Indies under colonial rule. He said, come to Ghana, you know, let's come and help me build a United States of Africa.
Right.
And so all these people came from all over the world, from America, and it was a really exciting time. So Ulric now, he served in Ghana as a lawyer. He helped, you know, with the rewriting of the constitution.
Right.
Because they had to change the constitution from a colonial constitution to the constitution of a country that was independent, where the resources of the country would belong to the people,
right,
not to the powers that were taking them out, right? Mm. And then Nkrumah sent him to Cameroon, which had just become independent. Mm. And there was a need for, you know, a senior legal person there, and he became the Attorney General in Cameroon.
Wow.
Yeah. And he's in the history books in Cameroon. He's gotten awards in Cameroon. And then after that, he was in Cameroon for 9 years.
Yeah.
He was asked to go to Tanzania, mm-hmm. where he worked alongside Julius Nyerere, who was a visionary African leader. He had an incredible idea that, you know, African people, he had an idea, a theory called, I can't remember what it was called.
No,
but he had this theory that he arranged the whole country into villages and socialist villages.
Okay.
Ujamaa. Mm. Which was that, you know, you could arrange the place into socialist villages where everybody helped each other and so on. And so, and a lot of people were in Tanzania at the time. You know, Tanzania was like the epicenter of the movement.
Right.
You know, Tanzania, the University of Dar es Salaam at the time housed a military training center where, you know, exiles from South Africa and Mozambique were trained there and then went back to the front line to fight. Mm-hmm. They had an intellectual center like no other, where they taught African history and strategy and, you know, military thought. Mm-hmm. It was a very exciting place, and Nyerere was a visionary and charismatic leader. So Ulric was head of the dean of the School of Law at the university, and he started the first industrial court. And I mean, but beyond Ulric, the journey of that character talks about a whole lot of people and history that we don't know about.
I was going to say, there's so much here, and it seems like such a rich story, not just about the one main character, but everything that he goes through and every step he takes unlocks another door of more that we haven't heard before.
Yeah, and I think it helps us living now to know, you know, when you know, in this reality now, because ultimately the Pan-African movement was destroyed.
Right.
You know, it was destroyed by the colonial powers. They had no intention of giving up the wealth that they were mining out of Africa.
Right.
Africa is the most, you know, valuable continent. It's got the most natural resources in the world. They were having a great time, you know, enriching themselves from Africa's soil at the expense of its people, had no intention of giving that up. So they killed our leaders, they undermined our governments right from the beginning, and did everything they could to destroy this movement of self-government that was sweeping the continent and the world at the time. Mm-hmm. And they succeeded, you know? So I think for that reason, we don't know a lot about that period of history, which was like a beautiful golden moment. I mean, it wasn't that great because, you know, Lumumba was killed.
Right.
There was a lot of terrible things going on. But in terms of the ambition and the vision of the moment and the leaders who were at the forefront of that time, it was extraordinary.
Of course.
We don't know about those people.
So how do you think, I'm getting into this now, I feel like I'm learning from a family member. How do you think learning about stories about leaders like this and heroes like Ulric, for example, would affect today's generation of the black youth growing up? because, as I said, when I was growing up, I didn't hear about these stories. I didn't know about all of this going on. I was young at the time. But how do you think these stories would affect the youth developing today?
Well, I see it because a lot of the crew, the actors who worked with me, who have worked with me on the film and on my films generally, they are young black people, you know, men, a lot of them are men. And I see the effect that it has on them to learn about that history. I think that growing up in a society like this, or even in the Caribbean, or even in Africa, even in Ghana, there's a huge ignorance about that period, about our history. And so a lot of young people are quite lost, you know. They don't know who they are or where they're going. And they, you know, there's an anxiety. There's a lot of lack of direction, you know. And I've seen the effect that it has on young people to learn about their past and what it does to them to know that, you know, there were people, that there are places and people who went before them who were powerful, who bestrode the world, who had big, huge visions and who led movements and changed the planet.
They set a foundation for us.
And on whose broad shoulders we stand. And it gives you a kind of clarity about who you are and where you're going and why you're coming, you know, you're facing. A lot of young people think that the racism that they face in the society at the moment, it's the first time they're having this idea in their head.
Right.
Or the first time that anybody's thinking about these things, you know. They don't realize that, you know, that in the 19th century, there were black people in the Caribbean writing books about Pan-Africanism.
Right.
That there were slaves or, you know, enslaved peoples who were plotting to overthrow colonialism and, you know, liberate Africa because they had that memory and they made it happen.
Right. Wow. I have so many questions. Probably for a set for conversation. But in your experience as a filmmaker and director, what advice would you give this generation of filmmakers and directors today? People that are in school, they want to get into the industry, but they don't know how to take that step into getting a film into TIFF, for example, or how to get something onto a broad scale.
Think carefully.
Take your time. There's no wrong answer, I'm sure, but
it's very, very difficult.
Of course.
It's so hard.
Right.
It's a very difficult industry. But if you think you have what it takes to, you know, to be a film director, this is the time. You know, now is the time. There is an openness to the stories that we have and the stories that we want to tell, for sure.
Fantastic. And the last question that I always finish off with, if you could have any superpower in the world, what would it be?
Oh, I have no idea.
That's a tough one. Okay.
What kind of superpower would I like to have? What do you think?
We're looking at Holly behind the camera. Do you want to volunteer an answer, Holly?
You?
I don't know. What do you think?
Just to have some peace and quiet.
A vacation. Right. The ability to, like, zoom myself to Barbados anytime I need a break.
Okay, so teleportation. Teleporting from one place to the next.
Yeah, okay. Exactly.
We're looking at the production manager, Holly, behind the camera, looking for some answers.
A holiday, she's thinking about me.
Right. Well, we appreciate it. Thank you very much for the education, for the conversation.
Thank you.
Of course, Hero's gonna be at TIFF February 28th, 7 p.m. So be sure to tune in for that.
Mm-hmm.
Any final words for you?
No, come out. It's going to be, we're going on our world tour.
Yes.
So I didn't even tell you, we're starting here. We're going to England.
Okay.
We're doing a Canada-wide tour.
Right.
And then we're going to England and doing a city-to-city tour there. And then to Africa, starting in Ghana.
Fantastic.
And then back to the Caribbean. So we're tracing Ulric's footsteps.
Oh, wow.
And which is also the tracks of the transatlantic slave trade. You know, that's the journey that they took.
How do you think Ulric would feel seeing this production in place right now?
I think I'm I think because when he was alive, I would I was interviewing him when he was still alive. Mm-hmm. He would say, "What are you doing?" And be there with this camera. I said, "I'm making a film about you." He's like, "Really? Really?"
Right.
I think he'd be amazed. I think he'd be, "Wow, that's interesting that, you know, he's able to generate so much interest."
Of course. Mm-hmm. Now I'm interested and I have a lot of research to do.
Yeah. Come and see the movie.
I definitely will. I definitely will. I'll be there.
Okay, great. Of course.
Francis and Solly, okay. Thank you very much for your time.
Thank you.
And thank you for tuning in. That's it.